Romans chapter 8, verse 17. For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. For the earnest expectation of the creation eagerly awaits for the revealing of the sons of God. The apostle's telling us here that even creation, when I drive down the road and I see a possum with a couple tire marks in it, I'm like, there was some groaning that went on there, amen? You're driving down the road and you're like, ugh. And then you get about a half a mile up the road and you see the skunk, there's some groaning going on. When you see that, when you hear of a volcano erupting and destroying villages and creating mayhem, and creation is groaning. God didn't create the world with volcanoes and earthquakes. That's all a result of man's sin. I believe it's a result of the global flood that took place. The earth is under the curse of Adam, and it has been environmentally changed from the original state that God created it in. And it groans in expectation, waiting to be restored to the place of paradise and glory that it once had. For creation was subject to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it in hope. Because the creation itself will also be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation groans and labors with birth pains together until now. And not only that, but we also, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, eagerly waiting for the adoption, the redemption of our body. For we were saved in this hope, but hope that is seen is not hope. For why does one hope for what he sees? But if we hope for what we do not see, we eagerly wait for it with perseverance. We got to wait, and we got to believe, and we got to set our sights on the promises to come.
That's right.
And then we endure hardship like a good soldier. Waiting and trusting in God to come and do what God promised he would do. Not going to be easy.
We're in a war.
It's not easy to live this life that God puts before us. The real work's done. It was done on the cross of Calvary. But we have to walk in it. We have to give God room to breathe in our lives. We have to seek him. And then we wait. Waiting is the hardest work that any child of God will ever do. I'm going to tell you, waiting is harder than going out and knocking on every door in Grand Junction, inviting people to church. Waiting is harder to do than anything else that we put our hands to. You know why? Because in our waiting, we have to trust God to do what only God can do. And we want to sow fig leaves together for ourselves. We want to go out and make the promise happen. We want to go out and get the answer for ourselves. We want to do it ourselves. And you can't fix death. You can't fix all the sickness in the world. You can't fix your loved ones who have gone on to be with God. Only God can do that. So guess what? We learn to endure, and we wait patiently, trusting in God to do what only God can do. Hebrews 12, 1 through 4. A couple quick scriptures, and we'll get out of here. You guys getting blessed this morning?
Amen.
Amen.
What about the other half?
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Good and godly examples. And I want to share real quick here. There are some people in this church that are here week in and week out. They don't let anything deter them from the house of God. And they know who they are. And they come hobbling in here on their canes and their walkers. And they're just ready to live in the presence of God. Why? Because they got a hold of something. And then there's others of us. We get a hangnail, it's like, oh, that's going to hurt. I better stay home today. I wonder if Jesus, when he was laying on the cross, when they would have drove the first nail into his hand, said, ooh, that hurt. Okay, I'm done. Get off. Angels, come and get me. Now, I'm not saying that there's not times we have to miss church, because we do. There's times when we get sick, and we're not supposed to be here infecting everybody. Please don't misinterpret what I'm saying. What I'm saying to you is that we often, too often, look for excuses. When God wants to bring a couple centurions into our lives and watch them be converted by our suffering and the hope and the steadfast perseverance and the pressing through that He wants to show in our lives when we surrender and submit to Him in the things that challenge us.
That's right.
Look at what the Word of God says in Hebrews chapter 12 about Jesus' suffering. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, those were the treasures that are laid up in heaven, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before Him endured the cross. Everybody say, endured the cross.
Endured the cross.
You have to endure some things. And our endurance doesn't give us a license to go out and get drunk. Our endurance doesn't give us a license to get mad and kick the dog. Our endurance doesn't give us a license to treat other people around us with contempt and disrespect because we're suffering that. That entitles me to go out in the community and be a devil. That's not what endurance looks like from God's point of view.
That's right.
We suffer with dignity and grace, magnifying the example of Christ. We don't go around spewing vomit out of our mouths, reviling dignitaries, speaking evil words against our leaders, getting drunk and high because we had a bad day at the office. That's not the suffering that God's talking about here. You don't have a right to cause somebody else to suffer because you're suffering. That's a double indemnity, and God will hold us accountable for such thinking. Believe that.